worship you. We come before your presence with singing. God, we come with joyful hearts. We come to celebrate you this morning. I worship you today. I worship you today. I wonder if you would offer the Lord a hand clap of praise in this room that would rival any celebration anywhere, that would compare to any praise by anybody. I wish someone would just give that to the Lord for a moment this morning. It's Victoria Day weekend. That's when we honor the royalty of our country. But we've come into this room to honor a greater royalty, to honor the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords in this room. He's here. Jesus is here. Queen Victoria probably not going to make it to Fredericton this weekend, but I tell you what, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the God of all glory, stood down from heaven to come amongst us in this room today. I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for that. I'm thankful for that. You would turn with me to the book of Ecclesiastes, written by Solomon. His wisdom came from God after his request and petition. Anything he could have asked for, and he sought for wisdom, and God honored him with wisdom, and then with wisdom came everything else that people desire. But we're turning to Ecclesiastes chapter 7. I'm wondering if you would stand with me in honor to the reading of the word of the Lord this morning. I thank you for being with us. And I know that Pastor Mike already mentioned that we have many that are away this morning, busy doing the work of God in other places. And I'm grateful that you're all here doing the work of God right here with us. How many are ready to hear a word from the Lord this morning? Someone say the end of a thing. Ecclesiastes chapter 7 and verse 8. Better. How many like better things? Better is the end of a thing than the beginning thereof. And the patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. One of the challenges that we face in our generation is that we have a lot to be proud of. Scripturally speaking, relative to what the wisdom coming to us through this verse talks about, we have a lot that we can be proud of. Much things, many accolades, much activity. We can be proud of a lot of things, but sometimes God allows us to wait through a patient season because God knows that the end of a thing is better than the beginning. And God has a plan for every life in this room this morning. And I'd like us to think, because it's easy in the middle of a thing to get lost in the thing. But if we focus that God has a plan for the end of a thing, can I just tell you that anything can happen? God has a plan for us this morning, and I just kind of like us to put all of our anticipation on the shelf. I'd like for us to take anything that we had planned for this service and just kind of move it aside and say, God, I'm replacing my will with your will this morning. I'm allowing your kingdom to come into my life, and I'm allowing your kingdom to come in this room. Our kingdom, man, I tell you what, we can set up shop in 5 minutes flat. We can put the walls up of our own personal kingdoms by the time we sit down in the pew, but if we'll just for a moment this morning let the kingdom of God come in this place, who knows what God could do in just a few moments if we let his kingdom come. So I wish you just kind of do a demolition of your own personal kingdom, whatever palace you've created for a few moments in service, the few moments that we've been here together. I wish you just kind of tear that down for a minute and let the kingdom of God come into being in our lives in this room this morning. Would you just kind of lift a hand together and say, God, let your kingdom come and let your will be done in this room this morning. God, we're praying that your kingdom would come. God, we're asking that you would build something monumental, something powerful, something lasting, and something eternal in this room this morning. We'll give you praise for it because you and you alone are worthy of all the glory and the honor. And in Jesus' name we pray. And someone just join me in saying amen. Amen. You may be seated today. I do understand my lot this morning. It's my duty to bring the word of the Lord to the people of God in the house of God. I understand that. I also understand that sometimes people come with the expectation that it's my responsibility to show you something you've never seen, preach something you've never heard, and reveal something you've never known. So I got my job cut out for me by some of you, but would you just kind of take that off the table for me? Can you take that job? There we go. Just preach the word. Just kind of take that off the table for me this morning, because sometimes the thing that we need to hear is the most obvious thing that we may already know but need to be reminded of. we need to be reminded of. I understand that it's a holiday weekend. It's a unique weekend where we allow the district to significantly impact our team and our presentation and all those kind of things. It's sunny outside after a long season of dreary drizzle. I've got us all almost in depressed mode here this morning. Let me just preach for a few moments tonight, this morning. Is that okay? I'm not sure how much of a theologian Shakespeare was, but I'd like to capitalize on one of the titles of his plays that he penned between the years 1604 and 1605. This is what the title was. All's well that ends well. I don't know how much theology Shakespeare had, but maybe you've never really stopped to ponder or wonder, or maybe you have, why do fireworks designers put the big burst at the end? Why does the climax come at the end of the book instead of the beginning? Well, you say, Pastor Jack, you're just asking silly questions. No, I'm serious. If we just stop and think about it, why do we do that? Not that we do that, or not the books that we enjoy that do that, but rather, why do we do that? Why do we eat dessert last? Aren't you ever scared that you're going to be too full from dinner and you're going to miss dessert? Why do we do that? The way that we do it. Why are the best games the one that you don't know who the winner is until the closing seconds of the buzzer buzz? Perhaps the bigger question is, when we look at some past event or some situation and we begin to evaluate it, sometimes maybe the question is how do we answer that question about why we do that? To make it concrete, think of a trip that you took a year ago. Did you enjoy it or dislike it? Would you do it again? Why would you do it again? Simple questions, but psychologists know almost nothing about how we answer that question of why. The simplest process to answer that question in our minds would be this, that you would take an average of your happiness level across the entire duration of the trip, and then we would equate that into the decision of whether or not we would or would not do that event again. I was happy, I'll do it again. I was unhappy, I won't do it again. But it's really not that simple when they begin to study and they begin to talk with people and they begin to do the tests that they do. And have you ever wondered where and when they do these tests? Like, you know, people were surveyed. Who was surveyed? How many people were? That's the questions I ask. Like, where were they surveyed? Where was this context of this quest that you gave to the people? How did that happen? But nevertheless, in 1993, there was a particular psychologist who began to talk to people about why they did what they did and would they do these things again. And he won a Nobel Peace Prize. He was a very affluent, very well-spoken, well-read, well-written prof. And I tell you, as he began to study this out, he began to realize that sometimes it's not so much what happens through the duration of the event, but rather how the event ends that really determines whether or not people will do it again. I'll give you an example. He let people sit in 14-degree water for 30 seconds and then ask them at the end of that if they would do it again. They said no. Smart people. He then took another group of people and let them sit in the same icy water for 60 seconds, but the last, and then on the end of that, added 30 more seconds, at which he raised the water temperature 1 degree and asked those people if they would do it again. And to his surprise, some of them said yes. Simply because of a 1 degree shift in temperature, because the thing ended better than the way it began, in their mind they had made the decision that because it improved along the way and got better toward the end of that thing, that they would do that thing again. And then comes into reality that Solomon wasn't just kind of writing things on the page, but rather it was absolutely true that when he spoke, better is the end of a thing than the beginning, there was some value and power to what he was speaking. There's power to the way that a thing ends. And if you think that just because humanity is smart enough to figure that out over 2,000 years, that impacts the way that we live our lives, can I tell you that God had it figured out long before we ever began this thing? And part of the reason that God tells us that the end is going to be better than the beginning is because he knows better is the end of a thing. God has a plan for our lives, and sometimes it's easy to get distracted in the middle of what we're going through, and we take our mind off the end. We take our goal, the goal that is at the end of this walk, the goal that is at the end of our life, and we somehow allow it to slip off the end of the table, and we get focused on the here and now and distracted, and all of a sudden we end up with people of God that no longer focus on the plan that God has for their life. Can I tell you that God is wanting us to realize this morning and remember, better is the end of the thing, so don't give up in the middle of the thing when God has a plan for your life. No wonder Jesus talks so much about the end time. Bible study and analysis would tell us that there are 1,944 verses in the four Gospels that contain Jesus' words. Jesus didn't just allude to the end times. He didn't avoid the end times, but rather Jesus preached significantly about the end times. He talked about heaven and he talked about hell. He talked about an eternity that would be at the end of our lives for every single one of us. Why did he do that? I'll tell you why he did that. Because it matters. Eternity matters. It's where we will spend the most significant portion of our lives for the rest of our life. It's where we will end this whole thing that we have begun. And if we walk the way that God wants us to walk, if we live the way that God wants us to live, we can live in the promise that Solomon spoke about in Ecclesiastes. Better is the end of a thing than the beginning. I'm grateful for how God reached into my life. I'm grateful for how God reached into the beginning of your lives, this walk with God that you have. Spent some time with my dad yesterday, and one more time I heard the story, the testimony about how God entered our home and how God ministered in our family and how God turned a mess into a miracle, how God turned things around that never should have been turned around. I listened to him tell us the story. I listened to dad talk about it, how God moved in, how a simple prayer turned my life upside down, around, and then in the direction of God. Can I just tell you that God has a plan for our lives? I'm grateful for the beginning of a thing. I'm grateful for repentance that puts us in the right direction. I'm thankful for baptism, where we're baptized in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ for the remission of our sins. I'm grateful for the beginning. I'm grateful that when God filled us with the baptism of the Holy Ghost, we got a power to live right and a power to walk right. I'm grateful for how this began, but I don't want to miss the moment, because even though it had a great beginning, God says better is the end of a thing than the beginning. And if it was that good at the beginning, can I tell you it's going to be amazing in the end. So don't miss out. Jesus preached about the end. He preached about heaven and he preached about hell. 60 of the 1,944 verses refer indirectly or directly to hell. But on the other hand, there are more than three times as many verses in the Gospels in which Jesus references heaven, eternal life, or his coming kingdom. 192 out of 1,944 verses, almost 10% of the time, he is speaking about heaven. Why? Because Jesus doesn't want us to get our minds off the prize. He wants us to keep the goal focused, and he wants us to know that the end of a thing is better than the beginning. The end of the thing is most important. And I know there's some people in this room this morning, you could say, I had a good beginning, but I'm too much like Demas. I began to love this present world. Can I tell you, there's still time to get your mind back on track from whatever you got sidetracked from. And God's saying, you don't have to be a Demas who gets written down in the annals of time that he loved this present world, but you can pull things back on track and say, I'll tell you what, I'm looking forward to that prize. The end of a thing is better than the beginning. Better is the end of a thing. Can you just tell your neighbor, better is the end of a thing? 192 verses of promise, letter written in red to us, tell us that God has a place prepared for us. Why? Because the end matters. Joel chapter 2 and verse 28, it shall come to pass afterwards. Everyone say, better is the end. He said that I will pour out my spirit upon all flesh. Your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. Your old men shall dream dreams. Your young men shall see visions. And also upon the servants and upon the handmaids in those days will I. Everyone say the end. Will I pour out of my spirit? And it shall come to pass that whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be delivered. For in Mount Zion and in Jerusalem shall be deliverance, as the Lord has said, and as in remnant whom the Lord shall call. I'm telling you that God made a declaration through Joel. He said, folks, there's a great beginning, but I want to tell you about a great ending. At the end of time, there is going to be a promise that I'm going to be revealing. There's a promise that's going to be coming. It's going to be a multi-generational promise. It's going to be a promise that isn't restricted to one generation. There's a multinational promise. It's not a promise that's restricted to one nation. It's going to be for many people, many kindred, many tongue, many generations, and it's going to be available to everybody. Why? Because the end of a thing is better than the beginning. And if God gave us that promise, I'm telling you, as God begins to talk to us, Brother Scott, and as God begins to reveal his promise to us, Brother Nathan, that we got to stand up and say, I'm ready to receive that promise. I'm not going to get sidetracked. I'm not going to get distracted, but I'm going to step in to the promise that God has talking to us about. If God said a 1,000 soul revival at CCC, I'm not just going to put my head in the sand and wait till somebody pulls me back out to tell me that it's happening. We're going to do everything that we can to ensure that we're living into the promise that God said is coming. Better is the end of the thing. I'm thankful for our beginning. Lightning. It was this past week when I awakened to the sound of a storm. I opened my eyes just in time to see a streak of lightning streak past a strike. Let me just say it that way. The moments later, what did you hear? Thunder. Which in our house is immediately followed by a panting chihuahua. You may as well just forget about sleeping at that point. So first the lightning, and then the thunder. As a matter of fact, they can tell you that if you count the number of seconds from when you see the lightning until you hear the thunder, for every 5 seconds, the storm is 1 mile away. Lightning travels at 186,000 miles per second, the speed of light. Thunder travels at 1,000 miles per hour, much slower than that. Sight and sound don't match. And sometimes, can I tell you that God will release a revelation of what we can see before we hear it. God will release a revelation of what we're able to possess before we possess it. That's why Pastor was preaching about praising before we possess, praising from a position of victory, praising God before it happens, praising God in the midst of the battle, praising him before we see it occur. Can I tell you that as we begin to walk into this thing, God is saying, church, don't lose sight, but begin to praise me in the midst of the process, because I'm doing something miraculous. And we can thank God right now for a better thing that's coming on the way. God's got it. He's promised us. We've seen the revelation of it. It came at us 186,000 miles per second, just like that. But the sound of it is a little delayed coming. But if we'll just count down, can I tell you that that storm that God has promised, the outpouring that God declared will occur, is on its way. We've just got to wait for it. We've heard it in the distance. We've seen the lightning come, but it's coming our way. Better is the end of a thing. You see, we have the day of Pentecost. It said when it was fully come, they were all in one accord in one place. And suddenly there came a sound from heaven as of a rushing mighty wind. And it filled all the house where they were sitting. My prayer this morning is that we would begin not just to hear that sound, not just to see it in the distance, but that something would begin to tangibly move in this room. That the Holy Ghost would begin to flow from the left to the right. God, move on us from the front to the back. Minister to your church, your congregation this morning, because we've seen through your word. We have a revelation of what you want to do, but we're waiting for the sound of it. We're waiting for tongues to erupt on every lip. God, we're waiting for every person to begin to declare the promise of God. No wayward heart and no wayward sons and daughters, but that we would have a people fully engaged in revival. That is what we are longing for. The lightning. 1901, the lightning struck. It was October 1900 in Topeka, Kansas. A small band of believers led by Charles Parham started Bethel Bible School. The school invited all ministers and Christians who were willing to forsake all, sell what they had, give it away, and enter the school for study and prayer, where they all would trust for God to bring them the fuel that they needed, the food that was required, the rent and clothing for the people that would be attending there. It said that no one paid tuition or board. They all wanted to be equipped to go to the end of the earth to preach the gospel of the kingdom as a witness to every nation. Their only textbook was the Bible. Their concerted purpose was to preach the word, not just with their heads, but to have scripture wrought out in their hearts and in their spirits. God, grip us with a passion like that. Like that. In this concerted purpose that they had, this desire, this search, this hunger, it said that they searched the scriptures. They went away personally. They went away corporately. They got together. They examined and studied. They perused and previewed. They walked through the word intentionally with desire. God, what is it that you want for us? God, what is it that you have for us? What is it that you desire us to possess? What is it, God, in this nation, in this turn of the century, in this church, God, what would you have us be? Who would you have us be? What would you have us do? As they searched the scriptures, they came up with one great problem. What do we do with Acts chapter 2? It was in December of 1900 that Parham sent his students to work diligently one more time. Search the scriptures for the biblical evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. It said that they all came back with the same answer, everyone. When the baptism of the Holy Ghost comes, in the early disciples, in the early church, the indisputable proof on each occasion was that they spoke with other tongues. Unanimous, corporately, that decision was made. They said the indisputable proof that we see in Scripture over and over again, Acts chapter 2, Acts chapter 10, Acts chapter 19, it's there over and over and over again in Scripture. Holy Ghost comes. God pours his Spirit out on the people of God. God pours his Spirit out on that. The house of Cornelius, God pours his Spirit out on the people of God, and tongues are the evidence. What was it that Simon the sorcerer saw? Was it that he desired? It was something tangible, something evident. It wasn't just a move in his spirit or a change in his mind. It was something that he possessed. It was something that they had that he saw. They knew that there was something there that they did not have, but the scripture spoke about. It was something that they didn't possess, but that God had available for them. And so when they had come back with that answer in December, they began to think about it. They were armed with this head knowledge. The lightning was beginning to flash on the horizon of the church of the turn of that century. And as they sought to have it worked out in their own hearts, they diligently prayed and they diligently sought God to do the work in their life that they had observed in Scripture. It was Watch Night Service, December the 31st in 1900, that Charles Parham pulled together his own students and people, 75 people in the church, 40 students gathered together. One of the students, Agnes Osman, asked that hands would be laid upon her to receive the Holy Spirit since she so desired to go to the foreign lands as a missionary. According to Parham, after midnight on January the 1st, 1901, he laid hands on her and, quote, "I had scarcely repeated three dozen sentences when a glory fell upon her. A halo seemed to surround her head and face, and she began to speak in the Chinese language and was unable to speak English for 3 days. When she tried to write in English to tell us of her experience, she wrote in Chinese, copies of which we still have in newspapers printed at that time. They continued the prayer meeting for 2 more nights and 3 days. According to Barham, we got past any begging or pleading because we simply knew that the blessing was ours. And the rest, as they say, is history. And lightning struck down in that little town of Topeka, Kansas. And God never stopped that tremor from moving through North America until it touched and hinged on every border, every nation, every kindred, and every tongue. And can I tell you, that was just the beginning. And if it was that great in the beginning, then God has a greater plan for the end. The end of a thing is better. Better is the end of a thing than the beginning. And so if that happened at the beginning of that century, can I tell you, God wants to do something powerful in this century, in this day, in this age, in this church, in this generation. God wants to do something remarkable. That was the strike of lightning. We're still hearing it resound. 105 years later, we sit here on a Sunday morning, a product of what God began back in January of 1901. It was in April of 1913. A Pentecostal holiness meeting was held in Arroyo Seco, California. Between 1,500 and 2,000 Pentecostals, mainly pastors, attended the meeting each night, with hundreds more filling the camp on Sundays. It was here that Robert Edward McAllister, a respected Canadian minister, preached that the New Testament invariably records the apostles baptizing only in the name of Jesus. That was the strike of lightning, and people would later write, that shot was heard literally around the world. And I'm wondering if God could let something happen in our midst that literally resounds around the world. In today's day, in today's age, I know that we're privileged with technology. We've got the ability right in the palm of our hand to send news to China right now. We've got the ability in the palm of our hand to talk to someone in Russia at this moment. But can I tell you, God wants to take technology and incorporate with the power of God and watch God do something miraculous all around the world. If that was how it began in the beginning, if that was the sound that was heard around the world, what could God do today? If we are living in end times, and we are, if that was how great it was in the beginning, in the end of the end times, how much does God want to give us the best of the best in the end? If the better is reserved for the end of a thing, in this end day, in this end time, in this end age, God wants to give us the best of the best of the best for the here and the now. I just wish I had about three people that would believe that with me this morning. I wish about three people would just let an amen out. They say, I can hear you this morning, Pastor Jack. I see the lightning striking this morning. I'm just kind of letting the thunder move around in this room for a moment today. I just need a few people to get a grip on what God has in store for us. I wish that God would shake us up from one wall to the other, from the front all the way to the back. I wish that we'd have Holy Ghost strike down in the usher's office while they're counting the offering this morning. I wish that the Holy Ghost would move all over our city this morning, simply because the people of God know that better is the end of a thing. And if God began it that way, He has more in store for right now. See, that's Holy Ghost right there. That's who we are. That's what we are. That's what we need. Someone just say, God, let your revival fire burn. Lord, let it burn. Let it burn in our lives. Let it burn in our church. Better is the end of a thing. Jesus told us four things about this coming revival, four things about an end time revival. Number one, it's a revelation, a revival of righteousness and holiness. John 12, verse 31, now is the judgment of this world. The judgment of the world is going to come in order for revival to show up. Number two, now is the prince of this world cast out. It's a revival of power. Some women say power. Now is the judgment of this world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. There is power. When revival touches the church, you've got power. You have authority over the enemy this morning. You have authority over sickness. You have authority over infirmity. You have authority over whatever the enemy would like to throw your way. You've got authority if you live in a place of authority. God has that plan for us in this revival. Now is the judgment of the world. Now shall the prince of this world be cast out. There's a revival of power in an end time revival. He said in John 12:32, he said, if I be lifted up, it's going to be a revival of worship. God is going to let a revival happen when we begin to glorify him. I wish someone would just begin to do that right now. I wish you lift your hands and begin to say, God, if we lift you up, you promised us, God, that there would be a revival of worship. And finally, he said, I will draw all men unto me. It's going to be a revival of increase. John 12:32, he said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. There is a drawing that will occur when the people of God lift God up. Something will happen. There will be a draw. And some of you are here this morning and you may not completely be able to articulate why. Can I tell you, it wasn't just someone inviting you. It wasn't just solely a decision that you made. I'm grateful for all that if it happened. But can I tell you, there's something bigger at work than anything you've ever encountered. There is a drawing that's happening simply because the people of God have dared to lift up the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. And God said, if we will, then he will. If we will lift him up, then he will draw all men. And some of the reason we have some of the people in our church here this morning is simply because we have determined in our mind, we're going to lift him up. We're going to glorify him. We're going to exalt him. We're not going to step back, sit back. We're not going to hold our tongue. We're not going to sit still. The rocks will cry out if we don't. So we're going to lift our voice and declare him as king. And if we do, God's promises are yea and amen. And he will do the drawing of men. I'm confident that God will continue what he has begun. And if God began something powerful in the beginning, he's not going to let it taper off to silence and insignificance in the end time. You look at Genesis chapter 1 and verse 2. The Spirit of the Lord moved upon the face of the water. If that's how God began this whole thing, God's not going to end it with his Spirit invisible, not at work, not seen. Can I tell you, the Spirit of God is going to move among the people of God. The better is the end of a thing than the beginning. Give me just a moment to talk to some people. If you're backslidden, if you turn from God, some of the most discouraging places that people could ever be in is thinking that that's not available to me. Can I tell you that it's to the whosoever will this morning, regardless of what happened this week. Regardless of what happened last month, God wants to take it. I'm not saying it's all right what was done, but can I tell you that God wants to make it right? He wants to justify you just as if you never sinned. He wants to cover you with his blood. He wants to wash you clean with the power of his word and of his spirit and of his blood this morning. God wants to do that work in your life today. You don't have to sit in this state of not sure if what we're preaching about is for you or not. It is. You say, well, you don't know where God began a good work in me. You know what? He told us he that began is able. If you let him in, he'll finish the work that he began. You say, you don't know the mess that happened since the beginning. It doesn't matter to me about the mess that happened since the beginning. All I know is that the end of the thing is better than the beginning. And if you let God in, regardless of what happened in the middle, God can turn it all around. God can make what was ever upside down, right side up, whatever was distracted or discouraged, God, whatever was destroyed, God wants to bring it back in and restore it, bring hope where there was no hope, joy where there was no joy, help where there was no help. I'm talking about a God that is able to take the mess in the middle and bring about a better end than you could ever have imagined. Someone just needs to get a hold of the promise this morning. Better is the end of a thing, regardless of what happens in the middle. God can make the end of a thing better this morning. As we come back to the music, John chapter 2, the marriage in Cana of Galilee. It says that the mother of Jesus was there, and both Jesus was called and his disciples to the marriage. When they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus saith unto him, they have no wine. Jesus saith unto her, woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. It was a not yet moment. Does everyone know what it's like to, you know, if you're a parent, you know what it's like to say, not yet. Maybe it's with dessert before the meal. Not yet. In this case, it was kind of turned around. When they wanted wine, the mother of Jesus said unto him, they have no wine. Jesus says, woman, what have I to do with thee? Mine hour is not yet come. It's not yet time. You see, there's some people that say, not yet. That resounds. It's a great excuse that the church can hang on to so we don't have to act. It's a great response to give when we're just a little weary in well-doing. We believe God's going to do it then and there, but not yet. It's not going to happen yet, Pastor Jack. It's not yet. No, the church isn't ready yet. We have not yet because, you know, in my mind, we need to be having more people in the prayer room. I agree with that. In our mind, we need to have longer services. We've got our ideas. We need longer preaching. Some would say, not yet. We need shorter preaching. Some would say, not yet. There isn't the right catalyst in the church. And some would say, not yet. Not. It's just a great excuse to hide behind when God is calling us to act. And here in this beginning of miracles, as the scripture tells it, in the beginning, God sets a precedent. You know, there's the first rule principle is a powerful principle in the Word of God. And included in scripture, in John, with the rhetoric, he lets us in on the conversation because he knows one of our favorite responses is, it's not going to happen yet. But I just kind of love Mary's response in this moment. He says, not yet. Her response is, why not? Whatsoever he doeth, saith to do, do it. Whatever he says. You see, the right response, Mary knows that in the not yet moment, if there is a few people that will do whatever it takes, anything can happen in that moment. If we just had a few servants, maybe not everybody in the feast is aware of what's happening behind the scenes, but if there was just a few that said, whatever it takes, God, whatever it takes for us to see the miracle, whatever it takes for us to do, whatever it takes, God, we're willing. If it means sanctification, we'll sanctify ourselves. If it means justify, God, we'll do whatever. We'll be baptized. We'll do whatever you're calling us to do. We'll live lives of holiness. We'll pray. We'll reach. We'll fast. We'll do whatever. And if there is just a few servants of God willing to do whatever is required of them, God can't stand idly back. And so we read of what happens. Whatsoever he saith unto you, do. It said there were 6 water pots of stone after the manner of the purifying of the Jews, 2 or 3 firkins apiece. That's how much they contain. Jesus saith unto them, fill the water pots with water. And I mean, these servants, you've got to admire them. It wasn't half full, it wasn't 3/4 full, but they filled them, the Bible says, to the brim. There are some people amongst us, and I'm thankful for them because God uses catalysts. It's an evidence in chemistry that if you kind of introduce a catalyst into a chemical equation, you can speed the equation up. Can I tell you that God has some spiritual catalysts in the church, and we all get to benefit from it? Don't get elite. Don't get a proud spiritual mentality, but spiritual catalysts. I wish you just kind of engage in the Holy Ghost this morning. I wish you just kind of, maybe you don't even want to acknowledge yourself as that, but if there's something stirring in your spirit, before we even preach about it, you begin to think about it. Before we even talk about it, you begin to declare it. In your private prayer meeting, you begin to talk to God about bringing a revival to Fredericton. You're a catalyst that God wants to use this morning. There's something in your spirit that God wants to turn upside down, and you're not willing for God just to kind of do it halfway or 3/4, but there's something in your life that's saying, God, don't stop until we're filled to the very brim. There isn't anything left for anything else but you, God. Fill us to the very top, to the work that you're able to do. And if we'll just let those people loose in our midst, who knows what God could do? Come on, just press into that for a moment this morning. Is there a Charles Parham in our midst today? Is there someone that's not willing to sit back? God, whatsoever you say, we're going to do it. Whatsoever, if it costs me my time, if it costs me energy, God, if it costs me my finance, God, if it costs me oh, my ability, God, if it means I've got to kind of sacrifice some things, I'm willing whatsoever you say to do. They filled them to the brim. And he said unto them, draw out now and bear unto the governor of the feast. And when they bear it, and they bear it, when the ruler of the feast had taken the water that was made wine, and whence not whence it was, he didn't know where it came from. Except but the servants which drew the water knew. It's going to happen, and people are going to be just kind of spinning around saying, how did this happen? And there's some servants that are going to know how it happened. But I tell you what, we're all going to celebrate in that marriage supper. We're all going to celebrate at that feast, in that moment. There are going to be some things. Glenn, it's so good to see you this morning. Had his mom's funeral on Tuesday in Perth Andover. I tell you, when we get to the other side, when we get over there, when we get to that land that God's promised us, streets of gold, walls of jasper, I tell you what, gates of pearl, we're all going to be there together, and we're going to celebrate the promise of God. We're not going to be saying, well, that is the person that did that work, and it's because, I tell you what, we're going to rejoice together. The servants may know how it all happened, but we're all going to take advantage of what God has available for us. And it's the same way here and now. God is going to have an end time revival. We're going to get to receive of the Lord the thing that he's about to do, the revival, the miracle, the flow that's going to happen in our midst. God wants to do something powerful here if we're ready to receive it. But God just needs someone, a few, to say whatsoever. But in keeping with this sermon, if we're going to homiletically tidy things up today, I kind of wish the Holy Ghost would just settle in. I'll just tell you, lately it hasn't been getting to the end of the message because the Holy Ghost just moves in. I'm ready for that this morning. I'm ready to stop before whatever I thought was the best ending for whatever God had planned for being the best ending. I'm ready for that this morning. I'm ready for God to move amongst us. I'm ready for 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 people just to kind of begin to feel the Holy Ghost beginning to stir in your spirit, because what we're talking about is resonating inside of you today. They filled the water pots to the brim. When the ruler of the feast tasted the water, which was made wine, and knew not whence it was, listen to what he said. Every man at the beginning doth set forth good wine, and when men have well drunk, that which is worse. But thou, because this is the way that God works, thou hast kept the good wine until now. It goes against human logic, human understanding. It goes against the first impression principle. Why? Because God knows that we can mess things up like nobody else in the middle. But if we let him in to do the work that he's called us to do, if we'll just let him have the reins, if we'll give him control, if we'll pass the steering wheel, Jesus, take the wheel. I'll use it if you'll hear it. If we give it to him, the end of a thing is better than the beginning. And God wants the end of this thing to be the best that it can be. He said, thou hast kept the good wine until now. I'm grateful for everything that happened in our history. I'm grateful for 1901. I'm grateful for 1914, 15. I'm grateful for how God has moved. I'm grateful for a fellowship of ministers that believes this truth and preaches it with everything that they have. I'm grateful for generations before me that stood on the solid rock. I'm grateful for people that declared truth when the tomatoes were flying their way. I'm thankful for a little chapel down on McGoins. I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful for where God began. I'm grateful for what God started. I'm thankful for people in this room. I remember talking to some of you, and they said, when we built the old sanctuary over here, that when they were up on the rafters and they were pounding those boards into the rafters and the hammers were swinging and the nails were singing, the men were up there and they were praising and calling out to God. I remember talking to Ron McCoy, telling me about how that happened, and he said, you could hear the building and the singing happening all the way down through Marysville. What a treasure! What a heritage! What a powerful picture of our history. Can I tell you, I
honor it, I treasure it, I revere it, I'm grateful for it. But can I tell you, better is the end of the thing than the beginning. God has something in store for us at the end that is going to just kind of move in and allow us to see that was wonderful, but this is incredible what God wants to do in the end. The good wine until the end. They said, none left. She said, not so. Mary said, nah, you got it wrong. Jesus said, not yet. She said, why not? She turned to the servants and said, whatsoever. He said, fill them up. They did what he asked. The ruler said, the best is usually first. But God said, I've saved the best for last. For someone in this room this morning, you gotta realize this is the beginning of the end for you. And God has something powerful he wants to do in your life, in this room, this morning. Could you stand together with me? Thank you, music team, for standing with me, playing with me till the end. There's just been tremors of the Holy Ghost ministering. There's just been a little revelation happening. There's thunder moving in this room this morning. I wish you just lift both your hands for a moment. I think God could do a work in the Holy Ghost right where you're standing this morning. There isn't any place in this room outside the reach of God right now. There isn't any heart beyond the extent of his hand in this place today. God, we speak against every imagination. God, anything that would exalt itself against your purpose and your plan in this room this morning. Well, that's it, church. Just lift your hands. Would you pray with me? I'm not looking for volume, but I would love to hear intensity this morning. We got some of those catalysts I spoke about a minute ago. They're away, they're ministering, and I wish someone would just kind of slip into that role for a moment, shock someone near you. Come on, just release yourself to what you believe God has in store for you. Jesus. So we're going to open this altar in just a moment. But I'm asking if you would help someone see that the future isn't finished. But God, that the future is better than even the beginning this morning. So we let you in to do what you're able to do. God, we invite you to move in this room. Wayward hearts, redirect. Discouraged lives, God, I pray that you would bring courage. Lord, I ask that your healing would come to bodies broken. Lives that are wounded, God, I pray. Minds that need mending today, do the work you can do. It's better, it's better, it's better. It's better if you just let God in. It's better if you let him work. It's better if you let him move this morning. As we begin to sing, I wish you just kind of leave your pew for a minute, come to the altar. It's 12:15. We got time. Time for God to minister to someone this morning. If you got a need, maybe it's not even in your personal life, but you want God to make the end of a thing better. Maybe it is your personal life and you need the Lord to step in and turn something around. This is an opportunity. This is an invitation to watch God begin the end of a thing that's better than the beginning.
Open up the floodgates. I'm mighty rich.